Make sure you're right.
Just wave at him, guys. Just give him a wave.
I've got the slops on the table.
You do, yeah, good on you. Ready? Chucks.
Chucks, ready? Let's go.
Go.
Keep waiting for us, so we can just get a shot away.
Oh.
Army personnel were completing the hardest part of the Tobruk's loading, packing away stores by hand. By morning, Tobruk should be fully loaded with the remaining armoured personnel carriers, heavy equipment and another 77 soldiers. By all accounts, the crew are eager to get away at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning.
I feel quite proud of the fact that I'm going over there, and indeed I think my sentiments reflect in the ship's company, all of whom have expressed to me a keenness to get over there and do a good job.
The Tobruk will spend almost 6 months on Operation Solace, keeping supplies up to the 900-odd Australian soldiers soon to be deployed. For many on board, Townsville will be the last shore leave until they return. Working in cramped conditions and living virtually on top of each other, keeping high spirits will be a major task for officers.
We carry a ship's army detachment on board, making up approximately 15% of my ship's company. And if the integration between the SAD, as we call them, and my ship's company and indication, I don't think there'll be any problems at all. They all get on well together.
It will take Tobruk around 19 days to travel to Somalia. A big send-off is expected at berth 10 tomorrow morning. Murray Cornish, WIN News. By the time Operation Solace is over, Townsville will be very used to military send-offs. The final seaborne contingent to leave, HMAS Tobruk, will spend almost 6 months off the Somalian coast supplying troops as required. An emergency gas leak aboard the vessel yesterday didn't seem to concern many of the 77 soldiers who'll spend the next 4 weeks in transit.
Definitely worried about the safety of the Tobruk. We've got to be on it for the next 17 days.
Well, it's their job, isn't it? So it's not much you can do about it.
A bit excited, a bit nervous.
Yeah. Looking forward to it?
Yeah.
How about you? What do you think of the idea of him going?
I'll join him in another 3 weeks anyway.
The most dangerous part of the deployment, disarming the Somalian rebels, now appears an inevitable part of Australia's duties.
It's going to be a long process to disarm and get stability. I think the key issues from where we'll be operating in Baidoa, will be to try and establish a no-weapon zone.
While not wanting to comment officially, several military staff believe one reason for the deployment may be the coming federal election and the point scoring it achieves.
I don't think there's any electoral bonus one way or the other. It does cost us somewhere like $19 million, so you could pork barrel a lot of electorates for that.
Those on board must be wondering if Tobruk is jinxed, though. After mechanical problems in Sydney and a gas leak in Townsville, just 20 miles out to sea this afternoon, a sailor fell down, breaking his leg. He was airlifted by Black Hawk to Townsville General Hospital in a satisfactory condition. Murray Cornish, WIN News.
It was pretty dark, so we couldn't see much, except for, you know, a lot of anchor lights and that. When Jervis Bay was here, they reported that, you know, they could see, like, traces and stuff in the sky, but we haven't seen any of that. Mogadishu's out here to the left. I'm just going to get Steve to pan around now slowly just to give you an idea of what the landscape likes. This is like east coast of Africa. So what I'll do now, Steve, if you can just pan around here nice and slow, and that'll give them an idea of what it looks like. Okay, Steve's now panning along the coastline. You see one of the many vessels at anchor here which are in support of Operation Restore Hope. Our part of the exercise is called Operation Solace, but you can see it's a pretty rugged looking coastline here. There's not much to see really. There is evidence that they had industry here at one stage. Steve's panning along now. You'll probably see a bit of a factory there. Quite a few American ships in. There's American, Indian, Italian, a couple of Canadians. I guess we'll be spending a bit of time with them later on. We're due to go alongside Mogadishu this morning to the roll-on, roll-off wharf around about 10 o'clock. We'll do a medium Mediterranean moor, and stern door ramp will go down and we'll start unloading the army, which comprises elements of B Squadron 3-4 Cav. We've also got sections of Ramey, various field. Okay, like I was saying, certain elements of the RAR. That aircraft you can see looks like a Learjet. That's landing at Mogadishu Airport. Most of the intelligence summaries have told us that there's been various outbursts of fighting in that area over the last few weeks. The most recent one being against the Egyptians, who ended up in the middle of a big firefight for about 30 minutes. But it wasn't very conclusive as far as, you know, anyone was killed or whatnot. Coming into view now, you'll probably be seeing a few more ships of the multinational force. the frigate that Steve, I don't know whether you can home internet, can you? That's an Indian frigate of the cookery class. Funny lot, the Indians, they sort of go both ways. They got Soviet gear, they got British gear, so you know, you don't know where you stand with them. All right, we'll just stop there. The starboard side of the ship now, you can see one of the multinational force ships going past. I'm not exactly sure what that one is, but we'll get Jane's out shortly. The vessel you can see just behind it's the USS Tripoli. She's been around for a few years. That's a helicopter carrier, and she's running the show as far as the coalition forces are concerned. Out to the left there, there's a few more multinational force vessels, a lot of resupply ones. As I say, this is just to give you an idea of what our first day in Mogadishu has been like. What I'll do is I'll try and get a bit more footage once we're alongside later on today. Okay. We're in Mogadishu now. We got in, I suppose, about 4 hours ago and commenced unloading. In the background, you can see the US Marines vehicles which are being loaded back up because they're pulling out where the Australians take over. Our convoy is forming up. That'll be leaving later on for Baidoa, which is our area of operations. That ship that's in front of us now, that's the private Franklin J. Phillips. That's taken all the US Marine stuff back home. I'll just get Steve to pan around now to the right. And behind me you'll see the old fort and that line of containers. That line of containers is there to stop the snipers from sniping at the various port operations. On top of the hill there, throughout the day, you get a lot of Somalians just sort of hanging around and patrolling on top of the containers. You get the Marines and the Australian troops who are all armed, fully booted and spurred to keep them away. Outside of the harbour, you've got all the coalition ships. Most of them have been in and unloaded and just sitting there in support of the troops ashore. But things are fairly busy down there. We might try and get down to the stern door and get a better look at what's going on. All right. A little bit further around now in the compound here at Mogadishu. Captain's told us we've got to wear helmets and flak jackets, but there's really no need because it seems pretty safe. In the background, you can see the locals. That's where the problem's been. It's been on top of those buildings there. Reports of people, you know, sniping, but that's all been before we've arrived here. As you can see, the unloading's going fairly well. There's a lot of equipment around. A lot of our troops, you know, sort of talking amongst themselves, comparing stories. I'll just get Steve to pan around now. There's a group of Marines just in from the field behind me. I don't know whether you can see them, Steve. Come round to the right. Yeah, a group of Marines. Apparently they've just come back from Baidoa. They'll be going back stateside shortly. And on top of the containers in the background, you can see our troops. Their job is to keep those locals at bay, keep them away from the wharf where there's been reports of them pilfering gear, stoning the coalition forces, which makes you wonder, you know, these people don't realise when they're on a good thing. All right, but what we'll do now is we'll probably move a little bit further around. Steve's panning around to the old fort. As you can see, there's a couple of Marines up there with their Humvee vehicles and trucks. They've got some heavy caliber weapons up there. And same thing. They're up there to keep the locals at bay, make sure there's no snipers interfering and upsetting the loading and unloading here at the port in Mogadishu in Somalia. Okay, we'll shut it down now and go a little bit further up, and we'll bring you a bit of footage of the stuff we've unloaded so far. We're right at the end of the Mogadishu port facilities. I guess you could call this behind me the point of no return. Out there's where the convoys come and go from. Out there's the technicals and the snipers and the real danger. Still pretty safe here. You can see a couple of locals behind me. A lot of American vehicles coming and going. Some UN vehicles around and about. There goes some Marines and one of the Yank vehicles. A lot of the locals just sort of lounging around and not doing much. Not camera shy either by the looks of it. But as you can see, there's a fair bit of activity around here. I'll just get cameraman now to pan back around through 360 degrees. He'll back this way, and you'll be able to see the ships and the port unloading, just to give you an idea of whereabouts we are. Do you want to take that away now, Steve? Nice and slow. Yeah, okay, you can see there, just see Tobruk's funnel in the background behind all those containers. The vehicles near the black hulled ship and all those containers, that's the Marines pulling out. They've handed over the operations here now to Australia. And the vehicles to the left, you'll see our APCs lined up, ready for their convoy out to Baidoa. As I say, this is probably one of the busiest ports on the east coast of Africa at the moment. We haven't seen any trouble since we've been here, although they reckon over night time the trace is fairly thick and you can see the various clans warring with each other. Okay, here I am with a couple of blokes from 3-4 Cav Regiment. These are the guys who will be taking the APCs out to Baidoa. That's right, Baidoa?
Yeah, certainly.
Yeah, okay. How do you guys feel about that?
Oh, I can't wait to get there.
Yeah?
Can't wait to get there.
I bet you're looking forward to an interesting trip out there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Well, these guys, we don't really know what they're going to expect. We've heard all sorts of stories about convoys between here and Baidoa, some good, some bad, some taking fire. A lot of the locals sort of stoning them because they don't really know when they're on a good thing, these blokes, do they?
No.
Okay. One in every crowd. Okay, now what sort of vehicles are these we're standing near?
There's an ACV. It's our Armoured Command vehicle.
Right.
It's got all the radios and it's generally where we run the whole show from.
Okay. And what's your job?
I drive the vehicles, the APCs, the carriers.
Right, so you're going to have your wits about you on the drive out there.
Yeah, hopefully.
All right. Okay, guys, well, listen, you want to send a cheerio to home?
Oh, yeah.
Yep, cheerio.
There you go, that's the cream of the Australian youth going off to Baidoa. Thanks, fellas, and good luck. Here we are, day three off Mogadishu. Early this morning, about 5 a.m, we slipped from the Roro wharf in Mogadishu after completing unloading all the army gear. Couldn't believe just how much gear, when you saw it all lined up on the wharf, how much gear that we actually discharged. They worked quite late till about 2 or 3 this morning getting it all off. We had to move the berth to let one of the other ships come in and start unloading. So now we're back out at anchor here. It's about 20 to 25 ships at anchor off Mogadishu at the moment. The one behind me is the Vittorio Veneto, which is an Italian cruiser. She anchored there about, 10 o'clock this morning. It's now 14:15 in the afternoon. Behind the Italian cruiser, you've got a Turkish ship, which is a ex-USS Dixie class depot ship. It's called the Derya. I don't know whether you can zoom in on that, can you, Steve? Pretty old hull. The USS Dixie did about 40 odd years in the US Navy. Main activity today, we've seen a couple of explosions on shore further down to the south. Whether that's the rival clans having a go at each other or them just getting rid of old ordnance, I don't know. The chances are it's more than likely them blowing up ordnance that they've captured. News is that there's a sort of a uneasy ceasefire at the moment between Adid and Ahmed, the other clan, major clan leader. Whether that'll hold remains to be seen. I reckon as long as there's clans here in Mogadishu, the chances of them, you know, resolving anything are really slim. A lot of helicopters around at the bow, about to be overflown by Italian Sea King. It's just buzzed down the starboard side. A lot of air activity today. Resupply on shore. Our helicopter at the moment's gone into Baidoa. That's where the convoy of our APCs and vehicles left for some time today. So that's mainly gone in there for a bit of a PR stint. Shame we couldn't have got on the helo, but that's the way you go. Apart from that, today we've just spent today shooting a bit of light with USS Tripoli. We'll pan around to her now. She's anchored on our starboard quarter. I'll try and get Steve to zoom in on her. In USS Tripoli is Captain Peterson. He's commander of Task Force 156. They're running the show here in Mogadishu as far as the maritime activity goes. At the moment, she's been operating CH-46 Sea Knights, Sea Stallions, and some smaller helos as well. I believe she carries, in addition to those two, Iroquois and also the Huey Cobras. Well, that's about it for day three in downtown Mogadishu. A couple of the guys last night reported seeing tracer fire over Mogadishu. None of it came our way, though. It's pretty quiet as far as we're concerned. And I think I'll wrap it there for today. Okay, I'm just going to give a bit of a quick intro to this next bit of footage. This is a CH-46 Sea Knight from USS Tripoli. He came over on the afternoon of the 21st to do a vertrep vertical replenishment. You'll notice shortly the door will open on the other side of the aircraft and they'll start winching people down to the deck. I'm going to quit with the commentary now and you'll just be able to see the rest of it take its natural course. Okay, it's pretty noisy out here, day four off Mogadishu at the moment. We're exercising with the US Marines and the US Navy SEALs from USS Juno. Juno's astern of us at present. Ship directly behind me is USS Tripoli, which is an LPH. The exercises we're doing with the Marines and the SEALs today involve them using us as a platform to practice what they call, VBSS drills, visit, board, search and seize. So we're pretending to be a merchant ship and they are coming alongside with helo support, snipers in the helos, and they're landing their SEAL teams and Marines by a rubber boat. What I'll do is I'll get Steve, just come over now, and we'll get a bit of footage of the blokes in their boats. Okay, this is the port side of Tobruk. These are Zodiacs that the SEALs and Marines are in. Mainly these guys are Navy SEALs moving up the port side. They'll be boarding via the port shade deck. And once they're on board, secure the ship and carrying out search. They'll be looking for any contraband, anything that a merchant ship might be carrying and supplying to the Somalians, i.e. weapons or things like that. They've got two Iroquois gunships in support of them. And what they do is as these guys board, they take station, one on the port beam, one on the starboard beam, keep everyone on the upper decks covered with a sniper and also automatic weapons. We're talking to a few of the Marines and SEALs earlier. They're armed with Heckler & Koch MP5 machine pistols. Take about 30 round magazines or a 40 round magazine. They assure us that they can take a headshot at about 1,000 yards without too many problems. It's pretty noisy up here. We've got our helo on the flight deck. We've also got the Iroquois buzzing around covering the SEALs. All right, we'll get a bit more footage in a minute.
Right,
you're clear to approach my after flight deck. Here in H is presently 3.00 inches. Our ship flight line course 0.00. It's alongside the port side now. Looks like they're having a bit of difficulty there, going around for another run. It's one of the covering Iroquois. What they've been doing is passing fairly closely up the port side, flaring, and then covering their own troops. Fairly well armed by the looks of things. pre-recorded interviews. The first one was shot earlier today with Colonel Mellor, who's in charge of the Australian forces here in Mogadishu. Must apologise for the poor lighting. Just bear with us. We'll have that right by the end of this trip, one way or the other. Over to Colonel Mellor. With Colonel Mellor, who's in charge of the Australian forces here in Mogadishu. Welcome, sir.
Thanks very much. It's good to be on TITS.
Yeah. Colonel Mellor's just telling me he's been here for about a month. I'm just going to ask him a little bit about some of his experiences over the last month. We've heard some fairly vivid reports of the activity in and around Mogadishu, sir. Have you got any you'd like to relate?
Yeah, well, it's been perhaps the most interesting month of my life so far. There's no doubt about that. It's, I suppose, New Year's Eve comes to mind immediately. There was a few bangs and a few flashes, and we thought they were having a bit of a fireworks demonstration, but as it came on, it turned out to be an exchange of artillery between two of the clans just to the north of us by about a couple of kilometres, and we watched it for a little while, and then when we felt the shockwave from the rounds landing as they were getting a bit closer, we thought we might give it the flick, actually.
Not the sort of New Year's Eve celebrations you're used to.
No, well, we had one of our, one of the advance party had just arrived in Mombasa or Nairobi or Harare, I think it was, and turned on CNN Live and saw this going on, and he was coming to Mogadishu the next day, so that sort of concentrated his mind a bit too.
Whereabouts are you actually based, in Mogadishu or Baidoa, sir?
No, no, well, I'm in Mogadishu. I have the headquarters of about 30 in Mogadishu, and the other 900 will be up in Baidoa. We're based in the old US Embassy, which is, it's a badly burnt out and derelict building, but it's comfortable, it's workable.
From talking to a few of your senior NCOs, they've been telling me a few stories that it's a little bit, shall we say, lively around the embassy of a night time.
Yeah, there's a bit of shooting, yeah, it gets lively, but it's amazing how quickly you get used to it. And we had four rounds hit the building one night while we were asleep, and that also concentrated the mind a fair bit, I can assure you of that.
What's your assessment of the way the operation's going so far, sir?
Really well. Really well. As from the point of view of the move over here, JB and yourselves have brought the troops in terrifically on time. Everything's unloading. You can see how quickly the unloading's going here, and that's just made it a whole lot easier from our point of view. The movement of the troops in by the 747s and the C-130s has also gone pretty much without hitch. You can see the conditions. It's not easy. It's pretty hard to do all this, but you know, you guys have had it a bit tougher than the JB, that's for sure. As far as docking today, that was quite a feat.
Yeah, well, it wasn't a bad bit of seamanship, that was it?
Yeah, yeah.
Just trying to get my rats in there with the skipper. All right, sir. Well, look, thanks for taking the time to have a yak with us. Are you a family man? You got family back home?
Yes, yeah. I've got three kids at home and my wife. Just before, I must say one thing about the CDT that we've had in the embassy with us since JB came, and they've done a terrific job. I've been very impressed by the way they've got in and mixed in with the guys, and they've worked extremely hard. We've now got the best showers in the embassy. We're charging for any of the Americans that want to come and use their showers, and CDT were responsible for that. And they wish them all the best back on board. I guess they won't be building any showers here, but I'm sure they'll enjoy it.
All right, thanks very much for your time, sir. There you go. TITS TV exclusive with Colonel Mellor. Take it away. Colonel Mellor, as I said, he was the colonel in charge of the Australian forces here in Mogadishu. We're now across to our favourite person and the most camera-shy person on board, the commanding officer, Commander Taylor. Another interview. We've just interviewed Colonel Mellor, who gave us the lowdown of Mogadishu. I'd like now to interview commanding officer, Commander Taylor, and get a few words from him about today's operations. Welcome to TITS, sir.
Thanks again, John.
Okay, sir, firstly, congratulations to you and the navigator on a safe berth this morning. I must say there was a few of us there who had our hearts in our mouths. What's your comments on that?
Let me assure you, my heart was in my mouth as well. In fact, the pucker factor was 10, but no, I'm happy that it all went off well.
You see, the commanding officer's human after all. Well, sir, it's fairly busy down here. I understand you had lunch today with a few of the high-ups in and around Mogadishu. Can you got any Any information you'd like to tell the viewers?
Yeah, for sure. Information so far is that, from what I understand, we've got priority here. We're remaining here now overnight and probably until lunchtime tomorrow. And that all depends upon when we finish loading. But we're staying here for the duration. And then on completion, we'll go and discharge our water to a water facility that's out here on off the beach, some miles down the coast. And obviously our program to Mombasa, then we're back here. My discussion with Colonel Miller suggests that he's supportive of us remaining here. But I guess we just have to wait and see now. But certainly from my discussion with Maritime Headquarters, we will probably be staying.
We'll probably. Roger, sir. All right, and how's the unloading gone so far?
Good, good. I think at this stage we've almost, two-thirds unloaded. In 3 or 4 hours, I think it's going exceptionally well.
Okay, sir. Well, as you can see, there's...
Why are you so good-looking, Chief?
Gee, I don't know. I might leave that one to the viewers. As you can see, there's a lot of armed personnel around here, sir, but from all accounts, it seems that the port area is probably the safest place in Mogadishu. Have you got any comment on that?
Yeah, certainly. Speaking to the US Army port control people here this morning over lunch anyway, they said this is the secure area. But you obviously, no doubt, have seen the snipers positioned up here on the old fort and around. So it is secure, but from my understanding, once you go outside the gate, you're in deep shit, unless you've got a flak jacket on or a helmet.
Okay.
In fact, as of yesterday, I'm led to believe that there was a US Army fellow driving a Humvee, and one of the locals leant in and tried to slit his neck. He got a cut on the neck, but that was about all. Fortunately, he was saved by his oppos.
Well, there you go, yet another TITS exclusive. Well, sir, that about wraps up the interview. Is there anything else you'd like to say?
No.
Okay, back to myself and Tomo in the studio. Okay, what? Here we are, day 10 in Mogadishu. We've just come back up from Mombasa after spending a little bit of time there for R&R. It was a two-day transit down there. We're in alongside for 2 days and a two-day transit back up. We actually entered the area of operations the same day that we left Mombasa, given that the area of operations is the 12-mile limit of the Somalian coastline. At the moment, we're alongside the American Condor, which is a United States merchant ship, which is used by the military. We were asked to come alongside her and provide her with fresh water because she ran out. So that's what we're doing at the moment. Now, behind me, we've got Mogadishu proper. We'll try and give you a little bit of a better perspective of it. Last time we were at the Roro Wharf, which is the roll-on, roll-off wharf, which you should be able to see behind me when Steve starts panning around. So, if Steve, if you want to start panning around now, I'll give a brief commentary on what you can see. Okay, now this here is part of the old port area. And coming into view shortly, you'll see like a big ramp, and there's a whole lot of stores that have been unloaded on it. And what I'll do is I'll get Steve to zoom in, and you'll notice that there's a wall, a stone wall, and to the right of that stone wall you'll see a heap of Somalian people. Actually, at the moment, they're running away. And to the left of that wall, there's a whole lot of containers, and on top you'll see Marines. And those Marines are there to stop these Somalians, who are sort of teenagers and young people. And the Marines have been trying to get rid of them all day long, because what they do is they'll fake a fight or something like that, and while the Marines go to investigate, they'll sneak around and start knocking off all the goods that have been unloaded. And that's the goods you can see on the wharf, on the pallets. It was quite an impressive rock-throwing fight going on before between one of the Marines and all these kids who were they started it, but they don't really know when they're well off. At this stage, the US Army are taking over control of the port, and you'll see a lot of the green vehicles are the US Army vehicles, and the beige-coloured ones are the Marine ones, which are still pulling out. The handover still goes on between the Marines and the US Army. Coming into view shortly, you'll see the American ship, the First Lieutenant Alex Bonnyman. There's quite a few ships of this class, they're all named after Congressional Medal of Honor winners, and they're the ones that bring over the vehicles. They have a roll-on, roll-off facility, and they're good for about 50,000 tonnes. What I'll do is I'll get Steve to pan back the other way now, try and give you an impression of what the actual whole city of Somalia, or whole city of Mogadishu looks like. So if we start coming... Okay, as you can see, that the shoreline here is pretty unimpressive. You know, it's all concrete and rock. And it's not until we get further around that you'll see, it almost looks like Mediterranean from what I've seen of, you know, photos of the Mediterranean. That's how I'd expect to see the Mediterranean sort of towns and cities. But it looks quite old. There are evidence of, you know, some churches and things like that there. One thing I've noticed from last time we were in, there's a lot more activity, a lot more people moving around Mogadishu than the last time we were in. And this is reflected in the intelligence summaries too, which indicates that the situation might be stabilising somewhat, although they still consider the risk on coalition forces assessed as high. Over the last few days there's been several incidents. There was one Somalian who was high as a kite on this drug called cat, who climbed the stadium. He had a revolver or some sort of small arms with him, 9 rounds in it. He then made a statement he was going to take out 9 Marines, chambered one in the weapon, actioned the weapon. The Marine promptly shot him in the forehead. He then fell off the stadium and it took some time for him to be cleaned up. It's been 2 Marine casualties now, 2 Marine deaths. There was a firefight the other night out near the university, and a Marine was killed after he was shot through the shoulder and also shot in the groin. He was evacuated to the Swedish hospital here, but unfortunately he died. Coming into view shortly, you'll see one of the wrecked relief ships. Don't really know how long it's been there, but that's the vessel called the Felix. Looks like some sort of freighter. I don't know how it came to grief, whether it you know, got caught in a storm or whether it was a result of the fighting that's been going on around here, but it really is anyone's guess. At the moment, as I said, we're outboard of the American Condor. While we're providing her with water, we're also transferring some of the stores that we bought up for the United States, bought it up from Mombasa, mainly building materials, wood for the Canadians, and cement for the Americans. What we're doing is, with the aid of the crane on the American Condor, we're transferring it onto the Condor and then she's putting it on the wharf. That just means that we'll be able to get out of here a little bit quicker than first thought next time we come in. Well, that's about a wrap from up here. We might try and get a little bit more footage from elsewhere on the ship. We'll see how we go. Okay.
So all these are like bullet holes and stuff, are they?
Quite a few around here. That's one of the better walls.
That's one of the better ones?
Yeah. Up all that one, up there, something
like that. How many people are living in this area here then?
There's 40 odd of us.
40?
Boss lives in this one here. We got senior NCOs in that tent, captains in that tent, majors over in that corner there.
Yeah.
And the rest of the six and MPs along the back there.
Right.
The candidates over the top one. And this is your attempt to really stop it and shrimp by people dropping in the nature of the
world. Is that all the earth moved up around it?
So again.
All the earth moved up around it.
Just
Jimmy.
Hey, mate.
Good evening. We're bringing you an exclusive interview, another TITS exclusive interview tonight with Lieutenant Colonel Graham Walnut, who's the Chief of Staff to Colonel Mellor here at Mogadishu with the Australian Forces. Welcome, sir.
Thanks very much.
I'm just going to be asking Lieutenant Colonel Walnut a few questions, and he's going to answer me as positively as he is able. Okay, sir. From your point of view, how is Operation Solace progressing?
Well, so far it's been going very well. What's happened in the last couple of months is that we've deployed about 900 people halfway across the world in a very efficient manner. The reception into the country was very well done, and the battalion group moved into Baidoa very well, and they assumed control of that HRS on the 19th of January. Since that time, they've been very active in and around the HRS, and what I've heard is nothing but praise for the way we've been going around our business.
Just for those people watching, sir, HRS, what's that?
That's called Southern Somalia is broken into 8 HRSs, which is called Humanitarian Relief Sectors. And basically there's one in Odua where the French are, you've got Bellatwine for the Canadians, you've got Baidoa for us, you've got Bardera where the Marines still are, you've got Kismayo, and you've got Mogadishu, and you've got Ballydogal.
Okay. Of those HRSs, which one would you assess as being probably the hottest area?
Well, if you mean weather-wise, I'd say Bardera.
What about action-wise?
Action-wise, I think it's pretty much the same across the board. Each of the areas have had their incidents. Kismayo has recently had some, probably a little bit more complications than other HRSs.
Oh, that's interesting news for us, seeing as we're heading that way. All right, sir, what impact has the Australian commitment made in Baidoa overall?
Okay, I think what we've established there is that a very good relationship with the people in Baidar and also the outlying villages. The other thing we've been able to do is establish a very good rapport with the NGO organisations, the non-government organisations, and there's 10 of those in Baidar. And what the battalion group is trying to do is to balance and to meet all the demands of the NGOs. And of course, they all want their convoys escorted, and they are, I might add. So we've got a very good relationship with the NGOs. And as we patrol through the towns and we sort of make our presence felt throughout the towns and the villages in the HRS, we're becoming, this flag is becoming far more familiar with the people. And they, of course, they all say Aussie number one. But that's if you give them food. If the Americans are there and they give them something else, and perhaps it's American number one and Aussie number 10. So,
right, yeah. So generally, the Australians have made a pretty good impression.
Yes, they have.
There.
Yeah.
Oh, that's
yeah.
Great. Okay. We heard the other day that one of your boys was wounded in a firefight at Badoa, Corporal Hodges. What was the circumstances surrounding that, if you're permitted to say, of course?
Well, in fact, Corporal Hodges wasn't actually wounded. Corporal Hodges was the section commander the section that actually was in contact and in the early hours of, I think it was Wednesday morning, and in that exchange of the firefight, there was one Somali that was killed and two others were actually wounded. The soldier that was actually wounded was Private Day, I believe it was, and that was on the next morning.
I see, so he was part of his section.
Yeah, well, no, that, two different sections. One section the first night, Corporal Hodges was another section the previous night, and Private Day was part of another section patrolling through the marketplace at Baidar on the early morning of the Thursday morning. In fact, what happened there was, it's no secret, the section was patrolling through the town. There was some people, there were people in and around, and a fellow actually rushed into his house, came out with a weapon, pushed through the crowd, fired from about 2 metres. The bullet actually missed his flak jacket, went in through the shoulder and out the other side.
So a clean exit.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was fortunate. Would you say that, was he obviously a clansman, do you know what clan he was from, or was he just someone who was high on cat or something like that?
No, I think we didn't. No, we haven't been able to establish from what faction he's from. If he indeed was from any faction, he may have been just a bandit, you know, related to or working for some faction. We don't know what it is yet.
Just a radical.
Well, I mean, they all have some sort of affiliation, but they can change affiliations fairly quickly overnight.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad it wasn't serious. Well, more serious, put it that way.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Can you give us a bit of a rundown on what a typical day in the life of a digger out at Badoa would be, say starting from, you know, early hours in the morning?
Okay, well, most of them, early rise, I guess you could say, and then it's a combination of depending on what company it is. Basically what happens is you have a number of companies that are out in the HRS is doing. There's one back doing security, and then there are other elements of other companies doing other specified tasks around the place. So an early a typical day would be for an early rise around about first light, do their morning routine, and the morning routine consists of, as you know, cleaning boots, cleaning, feeding yourself, cleaning your weapons and preparing for your tasks on the day. If they're escorting an NGO convoy somewhere, then it's obviously a matter of the section commander giving orders for the day. They've got to perhaps do some rehearsals if they need to do it. Because there are things like action on contact or ambush or something like that, so you've got to the troops have got to know what to do. So they might have to do a bit of rehearsing.
Sure.
Then they've got to know check the communications and then into the vehicles and off they go. Depending on how far it is away from Baidar, it might take them all day, and they might get back late at night. Other companies that are doing say cordon and searches, it'll take a couple of days to sort of square that away, planning it, and then perhaps depending on what time it goes in, they may have to get up at midnight, say, and be inserted by either road or air fairly early in the morning, so the cordon is in sort of by first light. So the days vary, but normally speaking you'll find that most of them work for 24 hours sort of pretty much non-stop, and then they have a bit of a rest.
I see. What about the tucker? What's the tucker like out there?
Well, it's a combination of MREs, which you probably know is meals ready to eat, a combination of T-Rats, which the Americans comes in big trays, and our 10-man and 1-man ration packs. I don't think it's as good as the Tobruks. Well, I know it's not as good as the Tobruks.
Do they have like a field kitchen out there or something
like
that?
Yes, they do. We've got a number, there's three kitchens in the Baidoa area, and it's used to feed a combination of both the ours, the Australians and the Americans. So we're working in operating with the Americans.
Sure. Well, there you go, people. Spare a thought for the diggers at Baidoa next time you're complaining about the scran on board. Okay, sir, wrapping it up now, do you think there's an end in sight, given that the date's been set for the withdrawal of the Australian forces, and we're talking about conferences for the withdrawal and that. Once we leave, do you think there'll be an ongoing commitment by Australia, and do you think Somalia's got, or is there hope for Somalia with this situation at the moment?
Okay.
It's a tough one.
Large bridge.
I think there's, to answer your second question first, is there hope for Somalia? Yes, there is. We've recently seen the raising of the auxiliary security force in not only in Mogadishu but also in Baidoa and other places. That's seen as a positive step to get law and order back into the towns. And as the village elders become more and more active in their roles, then we can see a return to normality for those people. As far as an ongoing commitment for us, all I know is that we're here for 17 weeks. That ends on or about the 19th of May, and we're going home. As far as a further commitment is concerned, you'll have to ask the Prime Minister on the 13th or 14th of March.
Depending on who he is.
Depending on who he is, yeah, that's right.
All right, thank you very much, Lieutenant Colonel Warnow, and bringing you a little bit of the insight of the Army's part in Operation Solace. Head back to the studio and continue with the news. Thank you, sir.
Good.
A little bit of footage of the shoreline of Somalia. We're back out at anchor again. It's the 22nd of February today. We came back up to Mogadishu after about a week's stay in Mombasa, which was pretty good. Most of us went on safari and got to have a bit of a, you know, relax, a bit of rest and recreation. We then came back up to Mogadishu to unload some stores. And here we are back at anchor. What I'll do is I'll give you a bit of a commentary as Steve pans around on the shoreline there. We've got the tripod set up today, so hopefully we'll get a nice smooth pan right across. All right, coming into view shortly, you'll see a naval vessel. I'll just get, can you see that now? Okay, that there's the Indian naval ship. That's the Sukanya, which is a Sukanya class offshore patrol craft. She's been sitting here supposedly in support of the Indian commitment ashore, but most of us here are pretty sure that she's just intelligence collecting. Although we have, she has been included in the multinational force schedule of events and major exercises. Sukanya class, fairly light armament really, one Oerlikon 20mm gun, surface search radar, India band, one helo, which is a Chitak helo. They're lightly armed and able to stage helicopters, fitted out for offshore patrol work mainly, but they have the capacity to be much more heavily armed if necessary. So that's the Indian naval ship Sukanya. What I'll do now is we'll just keep panning along the coastline. One thing that we've noticed since we got here, when we arrived here on the night of the 19th of January, it was dark and the only lights that could be seen were really the lights of the vessels at anchor. At that stage there was about 25 to 27 vessels, and I don't know whether you'll notice or not, but there's significantly less now. I think there's only about 11 vessels here now, and of those there's only three major warships, including ourselves. That's Tobruk, the William H. Stanley, which is a Beltnap class cruiser, and the Italian flagship San Giorgio. Panning across now, that's actually the area where the US Embassy is situated. Late yesterday afternoon, around about 14:30, we witnessed an explosion over there, which rose about 300 feet into the air. I managed to get a couple of snapshots of that, but we didn't have the video handy, but it was quite spectacular. Big mushroom cloud. We later found out that that was the Americans destroying captured ordnance and weapons from the various clans here in Mogadishu. Coming into view shortly, you'll see a stretch of beach, which just behind that you've got the airport. That's still a very, very busy place with transport aircraft coming in each day, Galaxies, Starlifters, C-130 Hercules, and you know, a variety of light aircraft. Since the USS Tripoli left in Juneau and Rushmore, there's been significantly less helicopter operations here. Still the day-to-day flights from our own helo and a few of the others, but nowhere near as much helicopter activity as when we first arrived. Mogadishu is fairly secure at the moment. There's still occasional outbursts from the bandits there and the various clans, but as I say, in the last week or so, it really has died down. That vessel that's in view at the moment, I'm not sure of the name of that one. I think it could be the American Osprey, but she's there, and actually she has an underwater pipeline going over to the airport supplying the aircraft with aviation fuel, and she's been sitting there ever since we've been here. She hasn't moved. Okay, just panning around now further to the right, you'll see a whole heap of sand dunes. Away from that vessel now, we'll pan around to the right, up to the direction of the port facility. And pretty shortly you'll see that an American warship come into view. That's actually taken over as Commander of Naval Forces Somalia from USS Tripoli when her and Juno and Rushmore headed up to the Gulf. Okay, now at the moment we're looking at the port area. I don't know if you can see those two white sheds just a minute. Actually, they're a little bit further to the right of that merchant ship that we're on at the moment, so I'll just get Steve to pan around to the right. Okay, that's the port area. That's where we've been going in and out of for our unloads. And if we can just come round now to the William H. Stanley. Okay, that's the USS William H. Stanley. Tomorrow we'll be doing jack stays with her, and also RAS approaches. And the day after that we'll be doing a RAS off Preserver. She's down south at Kismayo at the moment. So we've got a busy couple of days ahead of us. William H. Stanley, she's a Beltnap class guided missile cruiser. Good for about 32 knots. At got a range of about 8,000 nautical miles at 14 knots. Complement, about 480. Fairly well armed. They've got 8 Harpoon, surface-to-air missiles, ASW ASROC weapons, also fitted with a main gun battery, and surprisingly enough, she also carries a helo, which is a SH-2F. All right, so that's a bit of a panoramic view. That's what we see each day out here at anchor at Mogadishu. What we'll do now is we'll cut from that, and I'll bring you up to date on everything else that's happened. Okay, just bringing you up to date on all that's happened since we were in Mombasa last. We went down to Mombasa, as I said earlier, for around about a week's R&R. It was a pretty good time we had down there. We all got to go ashore, and most of us were able to get on a safari. I went to the Savo East National Park and also a place called Tata Hills, which was pretty good. Saw most of the animals there. Some of them were a little bit distant, but you know, you got to expect that. Anyway, while we were there, we loaded up with a whole lot of timber and cement for the Canadians and Americans, and we came back up to Mogadishu, went straight into harbour, and began to unload. As we were going in, we watched one of the American LCM-8 landing crafts recovering a body out of the harbour of a Somalian. I'm not sure how he died, or you know, whether he was shot or just, you know, killed by banditry or even just fell over, but it's a pretty gruesome sight watching him pull him onto the bow door of this landing craft and take him ashore. Pulled in there, quite a few changes in the port from when we were there last time. There's hardly any Marines in the port now. They've handed over to the US Army, the United States Army's 7th Transport Group, and they're in charge of all port operations and logistics for the whole of the American commitment throughout Somalia. And that's not just Mogadishu, Baidoa, that's all of the provinces, the whole area. We finished our unload there. We came out here, we've been doing replenishments with the Canadian ship Preserver. I believe Steve might have a little bit of footage of that, so we're trying a little bit of the replenishment footage as well, to give you an idea what that's all about. Most of the time though, we've been exercising with the schedule of events which has been promulgated by the Commander of Naval Forces Somalia. He's embarked in the USS William H. Stanley, which is the ship, I don't know if you can see it, just out here behind me. That's Commodore Sheffield. On this tape, I've put a couple of interviews that were shot on the TV station on board, on TITS TV, that's Tobruk Internal Television System. You probably will have seen by the time you get to this story most of them, but the next one coming up was probably one of the most exciting, because that was with actually Brigadier General Solomon, who is a general, the American general in charge of all the logistic operations here at Somalia. And he's been here since December, and he's had quite a lot on his plate. I was fortunate enough at the end of the interview I did with him to swap badges with him in true Perryman fashion. So, and that's it there. That's the one star of the one star Brigadier General, General Solomon, who was quite a nice bloke actually. Anyway, that just about brings you up to date. As I said earlier, we've got a couple of busy days ahead of us with William H. Stanley, and hopefully we'll get a little bit of footage of that for you as well. Okay. Welcome to our interview on TITS TV tonight, and I'll be talking with Brigadier General Solomon of the US Forces. Welcome to our show, sir.
Thank you. Very glad to be here.
Okay, nice to have you. I'm just going to be asking the Brigadier General a few questions, and as with the other interviews, he'll be as direct as he's able. Firstly, sir, what is your capacity in Operation Restore Hope here in Somalia?
I'm here as the commander of the Joint Task Force Support Command, which was sent over from the United States to provide logistical supply and support to the United States forces as well as all the other nation forces here in Restore Hope Operation in Somalia.
Okay. And which unit are you actually attached to, sir?
At this moment, I am the commander of the Joint Task Force Support Command, so we are a subordinate element under the Joint Task Force, working director for Lieutenant General Johnston, the Joint Task Force Commander, the unit commander.
Okay, so in brief, you're responsible for supporting all the Australian force, the American forces.
And we also provide common logistics support to the Australian forces as well. As a matter of fact, to date, we have given the Australians bulk water, bulk fuel. You've even been eating some of our tea rations, which are not as good as the food that I've eaten today on the ship. But we've certainly been providing that support to the Australian forces as well as some of the other nations here in Somalia.
Well, unwittingly, you've just answered my last question on how was lunch. So obviously, the general enjoyed lunch on board.
Yes, I did. As a matter of fact.
Whereabouts in Somalia are you based, sir?
Right now, I've got forces throughout the entire country. I'm personally at the old Somali University in Mogadishu. I've got about 1,500 soldiers at that location. And then I've got a group of folks in Baladoba. I've got another group in Baidoa. I've got a group in Vadera. And a fourth group in Jalib Kismayo. And so we're scattered throughout the country, if you will, providing that logistical support, to include medical support as well. We've got a hospital that's located at the airport, and we also run seaport operations with the Southern Transportation Group. So I'm in Mogadishu, and everybody else is scattered throughout the country.
It certainly sounds as though you've got a lot on your plate.
A little bit.
Yeah. Okay, as far as you're concerned, how is Operation Restore Hope progressing, sir?
From my standpoint, I think that it has progressed much faster than we had originally anticipated. As I can recall, when I got here on the 22nd of December, we were expecting to be in the middle of phase one and progressing rather rapidly, but as it turned out, we had gone through phase one and were also into phase two, which wasn't supposed to start until sometime around about the January time frame. So the progress has been on a fast incline, if you will, and it's been going much smoother than we had anticipated. So Restore Hope is working from my perspective. The starvation that we saw on television just before I got ready to come over, it's hard to see some of that now in the local area. You can see some of it still going on at the HRSs, but generally when you look around the town and you're looking for those camera shots of starving people, they're hard to find. And so I would say that from that standpoint, security has been established. the non-governmental organization have been able to get the food out to the locations where the starvation was occurring, and that is coming around, and everything seems to be going in the right direction.
Well, that's good to hear. Okay, U.S. forces, when are they likely to withdraw from Somalia?
Well, from my perspective, I am here to do the logistical mission, and at this juncture, we have a potential responsibility to continue as long as UNITAF is here and on into when Unison 2 stands up. And so from my standpoint, we have not been given a date as to when we will actually be through with the mission here. And we expect to be here a little longer than we're currently planning to stay for the UNITAF operation. So UNITAF, Unison 2, Logistics Task Force, the Joint Task Force Support Command, still has a responsibility to provide coalition logistics to the operations.
Obviously, you could be here for a bit of a while.
A little while.
Okay. All right, what part of the United States are you from, sir?
I'm originally a native of Texas. We had the Crocodile Dundee, and he came over with his Australian hat, but we have the Texas 10-gallon hats. So I call myself a true Texan, if you will.
Oh, that's good. And have you got family?
Yes, I have a wife and a daughter and a son. Matter of fact, the daughter is, I talked to her this morning. She is a legislative assistant for one of the congressmen in Washington, D.C. And my son is still trying to figure out how he can join her and get out of high school. So he's a 10th grader this year. So the family's back home doing fine, and I'm over here and participating in Restore Hope.
All right. Well, thanks very much for sparing us the time to have a chat with us here on TITS TV. On behalf of the ship's company, thanks very much, sir.
Well, let me just say to you and to all of the ship's crew, especially to the commander of the ship, Commander Taylor, you all are a very impressive group of soldiers, sailors, and you also have some Australian Army members on the ship with you. And y'all do an excellent job at what you do. We're very proud to have the opportunity to serve with the Australian forces. We're going to have a little get-together here to do a mission down in Kismayo to get some Army equipment shipped back up the coastline to Mogadishu. And you all have graciously given your time to participate in that effort, and we certainly appreciate it. So from my standpoint, it's a rewarding experience and a professional one to be able to do coalition logistics and do those things with other countries. So I appreciate it.
Okay, thanks very much for saying so, sir.
My pleasure.
That was Brigadier General Solomon, TITS exclusive, our first interview with a coalition force commander, and take it back to the studio.
Take over, mate. I'm a bit busy at the moment. Pretty sure I've got this right.
Thank you.
Three bags. One, two, three. Here you go.